Now, it's time to talk Celtics.
Step blocked by Jaylen Brown.
This is the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Over the shoulder pass for Al Horford with a two-hand slam.
With Gasper and Murray on 98.5, the Sports Hub.
Celtics are led by 7 with 3 minutes to go. And the Spurs have run off 13 straight plus these free throws to end it. And the game tonight in San Antonio ends the exact way it began. Celtics trailed this game 40-16 early in the second quarter. They had missed 28 of their first 34 shots and somehow gave themselves a great chance to win it. But the Spurs, scoring the final 15 points of the ball game, snap their 6-game losing streak and hand the Celtics another heartbreaking defeat on the road. The final score, San Antonio 96, Boston 88.
Sean Grandy with the call here on 98.5 of Sports Hub last night. Again, Spurs, like you just said, beating the Celtics 96-88. Celtics were down 24 in the first half and then had a hell of a comeback to take a fourth quarter lead. And then they went ice cold, giving up a 15-0 run to close out the game. Couldn't really buy a bucket, especially in that last minute and a half. Real ugly to watch. This I caught at the bar and then caught up with the rest of the game late last night. But an ugly loss for the Celtics last night. Welcome in, Sports Hub Celtics Show. Jim Murray, Chris Gasper. You, if you'd like to join us at 617-779-0985. Been a minute since you and I have done this very show, Chris.
Yeah.
And the Celtics, I think, had been kind of on an upward trend for most of this month.
Yeah, until this week.
Until this week, yeah. And I think, you know, and even I was like, oh, okay. You know, you've had Jason Tatum going off night after night. You know, feeling the love from legends past, Bill Russell shouting them out on Twitter. It's like, oh, okay, all right, maybe they find themselves a little bit. You have Jaylen Brown coming back from missing 8 games with a hamstring injury. Looked like he wasn't moving all that well, but, you know, I figured there'd be some rust there. But it felt like, okay, in what looks like a banged-up East, down East, you could start to believe a little bit here. At least even I was buying. I'm like, oh, okay, all right, maybe they can make a case for themselves. And then again, like you just said, they had this week. So now they're back at 500, 10-10, 5-6 on the road. And this was just a hideous loss last night.
It was, and I feel like overall, big picture, this was a reality check sort of week for the Celtics in that you go and you play the Nets and you get blown out in that game. You know, you get off to such a terrible start, 7-30 from three. You're looking at Jason Tatum, who got off to a 3-of-13 start in that game. You trail by as many as 29. The Nets just got bored, basically, and sort of let you back in a little bit and then just finished you off at the end. That showed you, to me, how far away you are from contending in the Eastern Conference. Now, look, I know they didn't have Time Lord. They didn't have Jason Richardson, so you want to say that. And then the Spurs team, I don't care who the coach is, they're not very good. DeJounte Murray's my guy. He's one of my guys that I've liked for a while. He had a really good game against you. But you can't lose this game, and you go down 24. It's the same thing. Tatum starts 4-of-14. And I just look at it big picture. You mentioned the 10-10. Last year they were 36-36. So we now have a 92-game sample of this team being a 500 team.
Right.
And if you're Brad Stevens, when do you look at it and say, big picture, this mix isn't right, it doesn't work? And I think we're reaching that point. Now, they can't trade Marcus Smart until January 25th because he signed the extension in the offseason. So I would say nothing is really imminent here in terms of a major move. But this is where I am, basically a quarter of the way through this season and looking at the last 92 games this team has played going back to last year. They're a 500 team. This fallacy, this fairy tale of them being contenders in the East, when do you give it up?
Well, I mean, it's been this downward slide here for 3 straight years, and it's all these same issues that you continue to see with this team, Chris. Why do they have bad starts? Why do they wait until their backs are against the wall before they decide to actually, you know, start playing hard? Why do they play down to bad competition like this Spurs team, you know, time and again? And people, I think, myself too, we got wrapped up in this little 8-3 run that they had in their last 11. It's like, oh, things are looking up in November. But no, it's just more of the same. So I don't know. So, like, what do you do? You know, are we back to who do you trade, Tatum or Brown? What's it? Because it's clear, like, the mix doesn't work. The mix, it just doesn't.
I mean, I still am not giving up on the Tatum and Brown thing. You know how I feel about it. I think part of the issue is they're on the same accomplishment timeline, and that is an issue that the Celtics have not been able to overcome. But I would subtract Marcus Smart first, just because he's easier to subtract. And also, I have to go back to Wednesday night. I didn't like what I saw from him, you know, getting involved with the officials, getting involved with DeAndre Bembry. And they mic'd up Al Horford for that game on ESPN, and I watched the ESPN broadcast. And he's just begging, imploring his teammates, just play. Don't focus on the officiating. Let's keep going. Just play. And Tatum can't do it. Marcus Smart can't do it. At the end, Marcus Smart is sort of getting into it with the officials. Grant Williams tries to grab him and pull him away. He pushes Grant Williams. Enough of this crap. Like, I'm done with this guy, and I've been done with this guy for a while. I think what he contributes to winning, while significant, is overrated. And I think if you look at the team being a 500 team over the last 92 games, one of the big things this year was supposed to be Marcus Smart is the starting point guard. This is where he belongs. This is the role he'll have. This is when he'll show everybody what he really is. I haven't seen it.
So how much of that, though? Look, and I'm as anti Marcus Smart as one can get. I don't know if it's as much as Adam Jones, but I'm there. Like, I think that if you need to try to switch things up, they should have never given him that extension. It's ridiculous that they did that. But how much of this maybe falls on the new head coach? Because I do feel like in looking at a game like last night, Chris, like, you know, you have inconsistency with minutes and roles, and
yeah,
their offense looks disorganized at times. I think in a game like last night, you want to see maybe less minutes for Al Horford, more for someone like Enes Kanter. Like, is a loss like last night's and some of the inconsistency you've seen on Ime Udoka?
I mean, he's a rookie head coach. I think there have been some rookie, I don't want to say rookie mistakes, but I think certainly some rookie growing pains with him. But I go back to the analogy I've used before. This feels a little bit like the Red Sox after the chicken and beer season saying, no, it's not that the mix isn't right with, you know, Josh Beckett and Adrian Gonzalez and Carl Crawford. No, we need to change the manager. You know, the manager's message has grown stale. And it was like, yeah, you know, Brad's message has grown stale. We need to change who's managing these guys. So we'll bring in Ime Udoka. At some point, like the Red Sox did that year when they got the Dodger Blue bailout, you have to sort of come to the conclusion that the mix, it's not about who's leading the players. It's about the mix. It's about the chemistry or lack thereof. And at some point, you have to be realistic about that and say, this just doesn't work as well as we think it should or as well as we want it to.
I'm assuming you read this Tim Bontemps article.
Yeah,
from right before the holiday. And I thought it was very eye-opening. Not that surprising, though, because I think it, you know, it's these unnamed sources. Name names! It's not how it works, you idiots. But, you know, you have unnamed GMs in the East talking about, well, I thought the most eye-opening thing was that you have people in the league talking about Jason Tatum, and there was a GM in the East that, I'm paraphrasing here, but he put it in that Tatum doesn't want to win. It's not that he doesn't want to win, but he wants to win on his terms.
Yeah, he wants
Chris.
To win his way.
And as long as he's scoring, you know, 25 to 30 points a night and winning, he's happy. He has no interest in scoring 12 to 15 points and winning a game. Like, that's all you need to know. Like, I just don't know if this kid's ever going to be a leader. I don't know if he's ever going to be what people think he can be. He's been in the league long enough. I just don't think he has. You've said for a while now, if you could have Jason Tatum's skills but the heart of Jaylen Brown, you'd have the perfect player.
Exactly.
I just don't know if he's ever going to have that kind of mentality, Chris.
I don't know, and it is a little disconcerting to me that maybe they don't rub off more on each other.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of maybe some of Jaylen Brown's mentality transferring to Tatum and some of Tatum's sort of skill and the way Tatum can see the game transferring to Jaylen Brown. Yeah, you would like to see that. You would like to think they could see the best in each other and try and incorporate that into their games instead of saying, well, I'm going to incorporate Kobe into my game and I'm going to incorporate Carmelo Anthony. I think you were mentioned on this too. I have a new laptop I'm struggling with. So I'm not signed into Twitter or TweetDeck right now, but somebody sent this to me on Twitter and it was Tatum from this week. Basically, it was a picture of him with Carmelo Anthony and him saying, like, I'm going to hang this one up in my like office or whatever. And I think you were mentioned on this as well, if you can dig it up. But I was like, yep, this is the issue, like right here. This is the issue, you know, that basically he's like, yeah, oh, here it is. I found it. It was for Slam had it. It says cut from the same cloth. It's Carmelo Anthony and Tatum from that Lakers game. And they have their arms wrapped around each other at the free throw line. And Tatum responds to it saying, hanging this one up in the crib for show.
Ugh. And that's, you know, his performance in that Lakers game, while, you know, fun to watch.
I do like the for show, though.
But it's also kind of annoying, though, isn't it, Chris? That, like, and if you look at his numbers against the Lakers, they're like, you know, these are some of his best games. Like, it's the the playoff Rondo factor or the primetime Rondo thing. Like, oh, you're going to turn it up because what? Are you trying to show off for LeBron? Like, hey, don't forget me on your next recruiting trip. Because I think LeBron's probably got 3-4 more years left in, left in him. Like, that's what it feels like to me. Like, you're showing off for the guy that you actually want to play with.
Yeah, in fairness to Tatum and Brown, though, again, and this might be unfair to Smart, but I'm gonna bring it up. Everybody says these guys have to take the wheel. These guys have to lead the team. Are they fully able to do that with Smart there? And do you get the sense that if Smart feels like he needs to follow Tatum and Brown?
No, I think he thinks he's on their same level.
Exactly.
That's what's so annoying.
And what's annoying to me is that this offseason, I believe it was Brad Stevens said, you know, everything we do is, I'm paraphrasing, is geared towards, you know, getting the most out of Tatum and Brown and putting them in the best position to succeed. Paraphrasing again. And then they go and sign Marcus Smart to this extension and continue to enable his behavior. So I don't think you can say that you're doing everything to put Tatum and Brown in the best position to succeed when you did what you did in terms of bringing back Marcus Smart. And I don't think you could make this trade now. Maybe you could have made it before. I don't know. But I look at a guy like DeJounte Murray as a point guard, and I'm like,
he's excellent.
That's the perfect third wheel for the Celtics. He would be perfect for them as a point. He's a great, he's every bit the defender that Smart is, at least perimeter wise. You know, I don't think he can take guys in the post like Smart can, but perimeter wise, he's every bit the defender Smart is. I think he's a better point guard. He's a better player. He has more offensive upside. He would be perfect. And I think there was a point where maybe you could have gotten him for Smart in a package or something else, but the way he's playing now, probably not. Like, the only way you get him is this, and now I'm going to be sports talk radio caller fantasizing about deals. But I do think somewhere there's a three-way deal between the Spurs, the Sixers, and the Celtics, where maybe Simmons is in San Antonio. Somehow you rob the Spurs and Sixers and get DeJounte Murray, and I don't know what the Sixers end up with in the end. You know, something from you, maybe it's Marcus Smart, and they end up with, say, like a Keldon Johnson or something from the Spurs, whatever. I think there's maybe that deal could be made at some point, but DeJounte Murray, a Tyrese Halliburton, those guys would be perfect for the Celtics as the third star.
617-779-0985. You want to talk about the Celtics, this two-game losing streak here that feels like more of, well, I guess the sad reality of what's going on with this team. And it's just the inconsistency with the offense, the bad fit. You know, we'll continue to dive into this Tim Bontemps article as well, where you have unnamed East GM saying that he wants to win his way. Like, I think it's all this stuff that we already kind of knew deep down anyway. But a lot to talk about with the Celtics, with this ugly loss to San Antonio last night. We'll get to your calls coming up next here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
1 hour each week at noon on Saturdays. The Sports Hub Celtics Show on 98.5 The Sports Hub. This is the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Three, got it.
With Gasper Murray on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
Before it started, I mean, across the board, you looked at us at halftime. The numbers were ugly. 2-for-10, 1-for-9, 0-for-7 from three of our starters at least. And so we talked about offensively playing with more pace, playing together, not trying to do it by yourself. And so obviously the second half was a different story there, where we scored the ball extremely well and just can't dig ourselves that hole.
Celtics head coach Ime Udoka on last night's 96-88 loss to the San Antonio Spurs. And, yeah, I mean, they caught layups in the first quarter and some good shots, but they missed 20 layups, too, and, like, it was all wide open, closer shots, 8-foot or closer. Nobody was hitting last night. Defense wasn't that great, and that had been kind of the calling card of this team during that little run there, that 11-game stretch, you know, where it feels like they've started to turn things around. It turns out Chris was kind of all fool's gold, right?
I mean, it feels like it a little bit. I do think you sort of got the reality check against Brooklyn. I really do. And that game to me sort of told you just how far away you are from being at the top of the East. And it's only one game. You know, maybe it's not fair for me to look at it that way, but when you lose that one the way you did, where you weren't really even competitive, to be honest, throughout that game, and you're kind of getting clowned by the Nets, and then you perform the way you did against San Antonio, I think it's one of those, you know, the old Bill Parcells, you are what your record says you are. And again, not to belabor the point, but they're not just 10-10 a quarter of the way through the season. Over their last 92 games, going back to last year, in the regular season, 36 and 36, like they're a 500 team. I mean, at what point do you look at them and just say, this is what we are, this is what we have, we're no longer in contention mode?
Greg in New York, you're first up here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show this afternoon. Hey, Greg.
Hey, guys. I just wanted to ask, this is more for Chris. I know that Felger and Maz had this idea that, you know, talent trumps everything in terms of the NBA, but at this point, with a sample size of several years, and I just want to ask Chris, when do the Celtics just decide this group just doesn't work and to completely reset? I mean, I know you talked about Marcus Smart as being someone to get rid of, but in general, I mean, you can say that Jason Tatum is all the talent in the world, but if he doesn't have the makeup, the intangibles, then what's the point? You know, so I just want to hear what your at what point do you think the Celtics just cut bait with this group and just re-rack?
I mean, we're getting close to it. You know, I mean, the trade deadline is February the 10th. And if I were the Celtics and it keeps going this way, and this is one of the points to me of the Bontemp story. I mean, I know there's all these sexy quotes about Tatum and Brown in there, and those obviously are pertinent to the matter at hand. However, it says the ever-tinkering Boston Celtics and the rocky road back to NBA contention. That's the title of it. Tinkering. That's all they're doing, tinkering around the edges. And I think, to the caller's point, we get to a point where you can't tinker. You have to dismantle and try and reassemble with something different and something that looks different. For me, it would be the trade deadline. I would already be there. Again, you can't trade Smart until January 25th because of his contract, the way that it works. And he does have I wish B-Rob were here. He could talk about this. But Smart also, I know, has a trade kicker. I think it's only $1 million. But he does have a trade kicker, so that's part of it, too. But that's the first place I would go because I think he's the easiest piece to move. And I think if you do that, you buy yourself some time, at least through the end of the season. Well, how does it work for Tatum and Brown without Marcus Smart sort of in there as the third wheel, as a guy that maybe is somehow blocked? And then if you still feel like those two guys, if you feel like the real issue is those two guys, then you can make another move in the offseason. You can make that move at the draft. You can make it in the offseason when maybe there's other superstar players available. It's a little bit easier. But I think step one is subtracting Smart, not because it's all his fault, but because he's the easiest guy to subtract from your primary three.
Eric in Wakefield next here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show. What's up, Eric?
How you guys doing? Love the show. I just wanted to talk about Robert Williams' value to this team. I was watching the game with my buddy last night. We were talking, just saying how we think, you know, Tatum is obviously the most talented player on this team. But when you take Rob Williams out of this lineup, teams get to the basket against us. We rely on Al Horford and Enes Kanter coming off the bench. One thing I also wanted to say was, you know, we can move Marcus Smart. I don't understand what we would get for him. I don't know who would take him. Maybe some team in the West, like Portland, where they got ball handlers, shooters. They don't really need Smart to provide any offense, just use him as a defender. But I think they should consider moving Jaylen Brown and add more pieces around Tatum and Time Lord. What do you guys think? Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I think, again, for me, look, there is some value to the idea of separating Brown and Tatum because they are overlapping players. They're on the same accomplishment timeline. I just think before you give up an all-star talent in Jaylen Brown, I would say, well, what happens if we subtract Marcus Smart? You know, is it easier for those two guys to coexist? Is it easier for them to function? I think you sort of owe it to yourself to do that. And part of that, too, is don't forget, I mean, Jaylen Brown, for what he is, the contract that he's on is a very favorable, like, it's kind of what some of you Celtics fans really thought the Jay Crowder contract was.
Yeah.
That's like the Jaylen Brown. It's like someone who can actually play on a pretty good, you know, contract for an all-star. So do you want to give up that contract as well?
Yeah. What kind of realistic return for Marcus Smart is out there, you think? Because I think, people, fans certainly overvalue him. I think the franchise overvalues him.
Massively.
What do you think? You're going to get like a first round pick for him? Do you think you're like.
Well, I mean, if you look at it again, I don't know because I'm not a GM, but I look at teams that have been interested in him in the past, you know, like a Portland, a Sacramento. Like, for example, hypothetically, would you swap him? And I have to look at salaries, but would you swap him for Buddy Hield to get some more shooting on this team?
Yeah, tonight.
Yeah, I would make that move too because they don't have enough outside shooting. Would you swap them? Let's say, your Hawks need a little more grit, right? I know. You hate me
just
right
a
now.
Dick.
Yeah, I am. Yeah, that's. I should get a T-shirt that says that. But maybe one of their wing guys. You know, what if you could get Bogdanovich from them, or Danilo Gallinari, or Gallinari and something else? Oh, I mean, would you make that sort of move? Kevin Huerter, a guy like that, who they just signed to an extension. Would you swap him for that type of guy? You might be able to get somebody younger with more upside for him. I don't know what his value is these days, but I think there are teams that look at his skill set and say, we could use a guy like that, and they'd put him in a different role, and he wouldn't be part of this, like, faux big three.
Yeah, and on the Robert Williams thing, like, I like him. You know, the thing that bugs me about him is he, misses so much time, either due to injury or, illness or what have you. And so in a game like last night, Chris, like you feel his presence being missed because you're getting so many minutes for Al Horford. And I feel like Father Time is kind of catching up to Al Horford, at least looking at last night, where it feels like he looks dead leg through whatever 20 games,
Minus 29 last night for Al. That was a tough one.
Yeah, not great. Let's go to Scotty on the Pike on the Celtics here next year on the Sports Hub Celtics Show. Go ahead.
Hey, guys, love the show. Love Five Questions, by the way.
Oh, hey, thanks.
My deal is I've noticed that Kyrie is very influential throughout the NBA. I mean, during COVID and all that stuff and everything. And you guys even mentioned the three-year fall-off there or whatever. So I was wondering, do you think that he somehow influenced, the Jays to be more concerned about their own personal stats and not about, sharing the win and getting the win for the team and all that. And if I could add a second one too, it would be you guys should ask the audience to ask five questions because I think I get some, I get at least one good one. I don't know.
Well, see, the thing with five questions, so here's the thing. We could 100% do that, but the thing about five questions is my answers are irrelevant. It really is a vehicle for Jim.
That's not true.
To rant and vent and entertain all of you out there. So it's not really about my answers to the questions. It's about Jim's answers, and Jim is able to come up with his answers ahead of time to entertain everybody. So if he didn't know the questions ahead of time, like I do, although Jim is very good at vamping, I don't think the segment would be as good.
Well, Scott,
dude, it would be good. I got a great one because I see Jim as kind of a drinking beer, wearing sweatpants, maybe spill some nachos, wipe it up with his finger off his shirt.
All true.
How dare you? Jim did CrossFit. How dare you?
I see you as the Seinfeld cut the Snickers bar with a knife and fork. So I'm,
you're not wrong. I mean, I will take a knife and fork to a slice of pizza. That is true.
Scotty, I'm going to let you go on that. On the Kyrie poisoning the Jays, do you believe?
Yeah.
I don't believe that anymore, Chris, because it turns out Kyrie was actually right. You know, when he was saying at that time, we need more of a veteran presence, which, I think undermined someone like Al Horford. But do you remember that this was like before that vaunted flight out to the West Coast where, seemingly everything got fixed and they started turning things around. But, this
Kumbaya flight.
that last year with Kyrie, I think he started to point out some of the issues between these two.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And how it felt like, it was almost too much too soon that they had already felt like they had accomplished something their first few years in the league, even though they hadn't won a title, even though they acted like they did.
No, I think there's some legitimacy to that. But I think, what was the Athletic story where Tatum a couple years ago said he still talks to Kyrie?
Yeah.
And I know that those two were close. They got along pretty well. Like, I had heard on team flights they'd hang out and stuff. So maybe there is some Kyrie. I know everybody here loves to blame Kyrie. But I think also Kyrie's kind of whatever he's saying to Tatum, I think there are things that Tatum sort of wants to hear and is receptive to, which is it's sort of about building your brand. It's about establishing yourself in the league. It's, this is what you do. Don't be conventional. Try and be unorthodox and all that stuff. And I think that's something that just naturally appeals to Tatum. My frustration with Tatum, I'm going to tell you this. I have the utmost confidence that by the time we get to February, whatever issues Tatum is having now will be a distant memory and he'll be lighting it up because this happens every year. He gets off to these slow starts, doesn't build on the season he had before. You start to question him. And then you look up in February and March and he's one of the best players in the league. So my frustration with him is like, why is it like starting from scratch every single year? And you have to wait until it's late January or February or March for him to play like the guy that he is.
All right, we'll continue to take your calls on the Celtics after this ugly loss to the Spurs last night. Couple open lines you want to join us, 617-779-0985. More of your calls next.
This is the Sports Hub Celtics Show on the home of the Seas, 98.5, the Sports Hub. It's time to talk Celtics.
Man, hotter than fish grease now.
This is the Sports Hub Celtics Show with Gasper Murray on 98.5, the Sports Hub.
Sports Hub Celtics Show. Jim Murray, Chris Gasper, and you, 617-779-0985. Celtics couldn't come back, close out the Spurs last night. They lose 96-88 on a 15-0 run they give up to the Spurs.
Over the final 321. They were up 88-81, as you mentioned. Didn't score a point over the final 321.
Yeah, to say that they went ice cold at the end of that game would be putting it mildly. So where do you lay the blame? What to do? I mean, it feels like we're just like on a treadmill with this team, Chris, for three straight years.
Yeah.
You know, like, well, who gets traded? How do we shake it up? That they gave that extension to Marcus Smart is like such a big part of this problem. Can you start somewhere? And you referred to the Tim Bontemp story that was, I thought, very telling, you know, right before the holiday it drops. And, you know, the biggest babies of Celtics fans are, name names. What are all these unnamed quotes? Like, it doesn't work that way, people. But it points out some of the flaws with this team. And, you know, Jason Tatum wants to win, yes, but he wants to win on his terms. Like, all these things I think we know deep down, but the tinkering aspect to it, like you mentioned, like, you know, they just do things around the edges.
Yeah.
It's not going to change if you continue to just tinker. You need a massive overhaul. And that doesn't, to me, necessarily mean, like, you're going to trade Tatum or Brown. But it does mean you need to move on from Marcus Smart, for God's sakes.
Yeah, and look, you might eventually have to trade Tatum or Brown. But for me, I think the pragmatic middle ground is move on from Marcus Smart and then see what it looks like. And if you're having the same issues, then you can move Tatum or Brown. But I think you have to start somewhere, right? I mean, do you want to go, you know, 0 to 100 or like 0 to 60? I think that's sort of the question. And when you look at it, I just think there's enough evidence here that trying to build around this core, these three guys, you know, we always talk about Tatum and Brown not bringing out the best in each other. Do you feel like Smart brings out the best in Tatum or Brown or vice versa?
No, if I had to guess, I think that the both of them were probably pretty frustrated by him more often than
and all, these guys, by the way, all get along.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, Jimmy's talked about this. You hear it off. Like, they like each other off the court. They hang out. It's just on the court. It's not a great fit. So it's not like, you know, as much as they might sort of bark at each other at times or whatever happens in the locker room or people throwing chairs down in the bubble, whatever, it's not like they, you know, don't like each other and it's like, get this guy off the team. I mean, that also might be part of the problem too, is that they do like each other. And I wonder if it would be a wake-up call for Tatum and Brown if you remove Smart. Because doesn't it just kind of feel like everybody, not everybody, but the main principals down there, like, they're just kind of on scholarship?
Yeah.
It's like, no, you know, you're a Supreme Court justice. You got a job with us for life.
Yeah. Well, the organization treats them that way, too. They completely coddle their star players. And you know me, I love reading too much into social media. And
okay,
it's, you know, one of the joys of having Al Horford back is that you get to see the tweets of his sister Anna. And so after the loss to the Nets the other night, I don't know if you saw this. Like, this is one I read right into. She tweeted, "I think it's really narrow-minded to believe the Celtics only need one or two guys to lead our team. Everyone wants to look to a single superstar," in quotes, by the way.
I like that.
"When in reality, it takes an entire group to win. Everyone brings something to the table. You win as a team and lose as a team, period." But that superstar, in quotes, Chris, oh, that's definitely a shot at Tatum, in my opinion.
Really?
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah.
Like, it's interesting. I mean, I do feel like Al is the voice of reason. And one thing I remember from...
And he already had to deal with this, too. Sorry to cut you off.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, but he had to, like, put up with these two before, at least one of these guys. You know that, like, he's like, oh, God, this again.
I mean, if I had thought of it and I wasn't in Thanksgiving-induced haze, I would have tried to pull the sound or at least send you the sound of Al Horford wired for sound from that ESPN game. Because, again, he is imploring. He is begging his teammates to just play. Stop talking to the refs. Focus. You know, stop bickering. Don't let your offense affect your defense. He is begging them, and it's all falling on deaf ears, you know, and it must be so frustrating for Al. But one of the reasons I like bringing Al back was that when they had that run without Kyrie and Gordon Hayward to the Eastern Conference Finals and got, you know, smoked by Jeff Green, basically, in Game 7
yeah.
in their own building, But I remember I covered a lot of that, and the affection that Tatum and Brown had for Al Horford and his style of leadership, and they respected him and they looked up to him. That was great, and it worked. And I thought maybe you could rekindle that if you brought Al back. Now, Al's obviously not the same level player he was a couple years ago, and I don't know if that's affecting it. And obviously, Tatum and Brown have elevated their game since then, but it doesn't feel like he's having the same effect. Like, he's supposed to be the adult in the room.
Charlie in Watertown on the Celtics issues. Go ahead, Charlie.
Hey, guys. So it has been frustrating watching the Celtics. And like you said earlier, it's annoying watching Tatum get up for the Lakers, and it doesn't seem like he can turn it on, and even in the fourth quarter, to get that killer mentality to win a game. 3-4 years ago, it felt like we were a shoo-in in the Eastern Conference Finals, and now it's like we're watching the rest of the conference blow by us. Like, you know, every team, Washington, Miami, Brooklyn, Atlanta, Chicago, the Knicks, Milwaukee, it's like we're looking up at the rest of the conference now. And I feel like 3-4 years ago, Tatum and Brown had they were kind of in their, like, prove-it years. And now, you know, they got big contracts. Tatum got a max contract. He's got the Gatorade sponsor, the Jordan sponsor. And now he's too cool for school. I don't think they can win a championship, just Brown and Tatum. We need, like, they're two Robins. I don't know.
Yeah, Charlie, it's frustrating in that, you know, remember this was like, you know, that SI article at the time after they signed Kyrie and they – where they trade for Kyrie and then they sign Gordon Hayward. It was, you know, talk of titles, plural.
Yeah,
you know,
they were Warriors East.
Yeah,
they were the Dubs East.
And that it's turned into this. It's more than frustrating. It's mind-boggling too that it's become. And I feel like I felt for a while, Chris, in terms of especially with Tatum, it was too much too soon. In that, like, they tasted too much success too soon. They thought it was too easy, and now they coast a bit. Like, I think that run without Kyrie ultimately in the long run kind of hurt them.
Yeah, you know, it could be absolutely in terms of feeling that they had it all figured out and what their standing was in the NBA. But I look at a team like Phoenix, and there's not a lot of Chris Pauls out there, but that's honestly what this team needs is a veteran pass-first point guard who can sort of command their respect but also run the show. Because, you know, my guy Devin Booker,
yep,
probably my favorite player in the league. A lot of people thought Devin Booker was a loser who just, you know, stacked up stats. Now he's on a team that went to the Western Conference Finals last year and has won 15 in a row this year. And you see just the influence and the difference that Chris Paul has had. And if the Celtics could find that guy, I don't know who it is. Again, maybe it's a younger guy like a DeJounte Murray. Maybe it's a Tyrese Halliburton, another younger guy. Ricky Rubio is not in the class of Chris Paul, not even close, but I still thought that was a guy the Celtics should have been interested in this offseason, and I was baffled by their lack of interest in him. Somewhere out there, there has to be some veteran guy that they can bring in who can play the point, who maybe can get through to these guys off the court, but also help facilitate their games and their brand of leadership on the court.
Yeah, this was, Maz and I have talked off the air before. He's talked about it on the air, too. Like, this is how this team frustrates you to watch. Like, I think at one point he's like, I'm just kind of done with them. Like, we have to watch them because of the job. But he's like, my interest level in them has just completely dropped.
Oh, really? No, I don't feel that way.
Yeah, no, like, there's times, though, Chris, like in a game like last night, I'm like, why? Like, why do you watch this? Like, it's so frustrating.
No, it's definitely frustrating. I mean, it is. There is sort of a Sisyphean element to it. You mentioned it feels like we're just doing the same thing over and over. You know, they push the boulder up the hill and it rolls right back down. There is an element of that. There is an element of sort of futility here in terms of feeling like, you put it best, like we're on a treadmill. There is, or like, you know, the hamster on the wheel. Yeah. That is frustrating, but I still do enjoy watching the team overall.
More of your calls coming up next. Couple open lines. You want to join us and bitch about the Celtics after their ugly loss to the San Antonio Spurs last night, 96-88. Your calls coming up next here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
This is the Sports Hub Celtics Show on 98.5 The Sports Hub. The Sports Hub Celtics Show drives the lane.
Goal! Scored!
The Sports Hub Celtics Show on Boston's home for the Celtics, 98.5 The Sports Hub.
All right, Sports Hub Celtics Show, final segment here. 98.5 The Sports Hub, run through with some of your calls. Celtics lost last night, San Antonio Spurs, 96-88. Back at 500, 10-10. Maybe felt like that little 8-3 run there might have been fool's gold. This is more about what they're about. Your thoughts on the team. Anthony and Easton next up here in Sports Hub Celtics Show with Jim Murray and Chris Gasper. Hello, Anthony.
Hey, guys. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. I think you guys touched on it, but the Celtics should have definitely got a pass first point guard in the offseason, someone who doesn't put up a lot of shots in the game. Because Smart is all right, but he just takes so many shots at bad times in the game. And if they do make a move, I think if they trade someone, they need to get rid of Tatum. I just think he's overrated, and I don't get why you guys say he's like a top player in the game. As, I don't know, he just doesn't shoot like that great of a percentage. He always takes bad shots and turnovers, like sloppy at the end of the game. And I just think Jaylen Brown's probably the better player on this team, and he seems to get better every single year. And he seems to have a lot more, care a lot more about like the outcome of the game. And that's all.
Yeah, Anthony, I'm with you on that last part. I think, you know, and Chris has said it before, if you could take the heart of Jaylen Brown and put it in the, you know, and put it with the physical attributes of Jason Tatum, you basically have the perfect player. Like, I just think you see what the scoring upside is with someone like Tatum. That's why.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's why people consider him maybe a top 15 player.
I mean, he scores so easily. It's rare for a guy to come into the league and be able to score as easily as he does. And I think that's almost one of the problems is that when thinking of it this, when you're a guy who can get your shot off anytime you want, then I think it becomes difficult for you at times to be able to discern what's a good shot from a bad shot. Because I can get like, I feel like, you know, if you're Tatum, you feel like I can get any shot I want.
Yeah, let's go to Jim and Douglas, who I think wants to echo some of the sentiments of that last caller. Go ahead, Jim.
Hey, how you going, guys?
Good.
Wanted to say, love your show. Wish you guys had the morning show during the week. That'd be great to hear this. But I think Jason Tatum should be the one to be traded. I don't necessarily think that he's the, like the last caller said, he's not overrated. I think he's a great player. I just don't think he's invested in the Celtics. Someone like Jaylen Brown, who actually, I think if you invest in him, he will invest here. But I really think Jason Tatum really wants to jump ship. And I think someone like the Spurs would be a great team for him to go to. They really need a player like him. So
thanks, Jim. Yeah, if you knew deep down, you know, you had the crystal ball, it would tell you that, yes, he is the second coming of Carmelo Anthony. Isn't it easier to cut bait then?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And that's where this could potentially be trending with Jason Tatum. Like, if he's Carmelo Anthony, like,
And that's not a knock on, like, Carmelo. I mean, I've seen Carmelo be great at the Olympics, but the reality is, you know, NBA Carmelo was always a guy who could score a lot of points, but, you know, struggled to elevate the team around him and the guys around him. And that is sort of, for me, that's a weird thing to say the worst case scenario for Tatum is a Hall of Fame player like Carmelo, but it is because, you know, Melo scored a lot of points, but in the NBA, you never won anything.
Carlos and Lowell, you're next here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show. Go ahead, Carlos.
Hey, guys. Love the show. I totally am in the Brown camp. I don't understand why everyone is trade Brown, keep Tatum. Tatum is never, ever going to lead this team to a championship. He doesn't have the makeup. You listen to him in press conferences, he's like milquetoast. He has no leadership skills. And it's cringeworthy to think that he lusts after Beal, and the Celtics could be put in a spot where they have to add Beal to keep Tatum happy, and then you've got a clique of two players that alienates the rest of the team. Are you kidding me? That's what you want? Brown is the team. I would tell you right now, if you could trade Tatum straight up for Zion Williamson, I would do that today.
Yeah, Carlos, I mean, I've been with you, but
Zion has some I don't think that body's built to last, and there's not a lot of perimeter shooting from Zion. But it is interesting. I mean, I guess it's an interesting discussion. I haven't thought a ton about it, but if you were to trade Tatum, what would be an acceptable return? Who would you trade him for?
So we've talked about this on Felger and Maz, and Zion was the one that was brought up before, and I was for that. But that was before I had seen recent photos of Zion Williamson, and you just touched on it. Now, this is he and I would get along like gangbusters because I love eating. Like last night, went out with some friends, already had the turkey dinner on Thanksgiving, and what did they have on the menu at the place we went to? A Thanksgiving dinner sandwich. Now, did I need that? No, but I knew it would be delicious, and did I ask for a side of gravy to dip that sandwich in? You bet your ass I did. And I bet that Zion Williamson would be down with that kind of behavior.
Oh, totally. He'd ask for two sides.
Yes. That is a young man who loves to eat.
But he's so unique, and so much of his game is based on explosive leaping ability, and I just don't believe that those knees can handle that frame.
Yeah, as someone that has put on some weight, I can tell you my knees certainly can't handle that either. So I'd be concerned about that and the torque you put on your body if you love eating the way that Zion does. I'll tell you, and I know you'd be giving up some size, and I know he just got hurt too, and thankfully it doesn't sound like it was anything too major. Ja Morant, I'd do.
Yeah, yeah. But see, here's the thing. I love Ja.
I think he's a badass.
He is, but the outside shot is still a work in progress. Tatum's a much better outside shooter than he is, and Morant, to me, is like this generation's Derrick Rose in that he's so unique. I think he actually leads the NBA in points in the paint, but he's one serious knee injury away from not being the same player, you know, in terms of, like, Derrick Rose was so special, but once he suffered that injury and he didn't have that same explosiveness, he wasn't the same player, and that's what I would worry about with Ja Morant. You know, that would be disconcerting. I mean, there's not a lot of players off the top of my head, I can think, like, I would trade Tatum for Luka, but like the Mavericks
would never laugh
in your face at that deal. They would never do that. I mean, I would trade Tatum for Devin Booker. I would make that deal.
That's not Chris Gasper bias, though.
Maybe, but still, I'd make that deal.
Steve and Whitman, you're next here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show. Go ahead, Steve.
Yeah, I mean, they're obviously not playing well right now, guys, but you got to look at the team that's around them. 4 years ago when they went on that run, they had a supporting cast. Now they got Grant Williams and Romeo Langford out there throwing up bricks. It's awful.
Yeah, so the supporting cast isn't great. And what about, so going back to the coach too, so this is something, you know, so I don't, you know, you mentioned Buddy Hield earlier, Chris. So the Kings, they just fired Luke Walton.
Yes.
They replaced him with a veteran head coach in Alvin Gentry. And, you know, last, I don't know if you saw this, but it's Hield, De'Aaron Fox, Bagley, Halliburton. You know, they play together as a team. They beat the Lakers in overtime. Triple overtime. Yeah. Even Tristan Thompson, 13 points and 5 rebounds. Goes 6 for 7
from the
field.
I will never stop taking a victory lap on the Tristan Thompson. You can say whatever you want about Mac Jones. Fine, whatever. I was wrong.
Oh, you were 1,000%
right.
But
Tristan Thompson, Jeff Teague, I was 1,000% right on that.
But on Ime, even though it felt like he was kind of handpicked by Jason Tatum more than, or maybe even Tatum and Brown, but it felt like this was the guy. But I don't know. Like, I think he might be a good coach, but does he get the kind of respect that someone like a real veteran coach like Alvin Gentry would get?
Question.
Like, I think he might be not a big part, but part of some of the inconsistency issues you've seen with this team this year.
You know, this team could use a Doc Rivers. And I remember
a guy that's won a championship.
I remember when Doc came in with the Celtics, and Paul Pierce has talked about this. Like, Doc was pretty hard on Paul Pierce, and those two guys butted heads. And part of it was basically, you know, Paul Pierce was like, well, I score this many points, and I'm a multiple-time All-Star. And Doc was pretty much like, that's great, but what have you won? Like, you keep playing like this, you'll never win anything. Like, I can make you a better player. And Pierce was like, what are you talking about? Like, I don't need to be better. Like, you can't make me better. And finally, eventually, Pierce, but I think there's a lot of parallels between Pierce and Tatum. I think they're very similar players. And I think that, you know, it took Pierce a while to get to that point where he was all about the winning. And they ultimately had to bring, they really had to bring a leader in from the outside in Kevin Garnett to fully get the most out of Paul Pierce. And it might be the same with Tatum.
Matt in Rhode Island on Jason Tatum. You're next here on 98.5 of Sports Hub. Go ahead.
Yeah. No, that game last night was just simply awful. And you know what? There's about 20 terrible NBA teams that Jason can go to and make $40 million a year and not have to worry about all this stuff. Also with the coach, if he handpicked the coach, then why do you listen to the coach and Al Horford, for that matter, and stop crying to the referees?
It's unbearable. He was doing it last night, and it was amazing. Let me look at the box score, because I can see who the officials were. And there was one official, a female official, that he was, like, crying to, and she was literally yelling at him, I didn't make the call. It was at the end of the game when I think Keldon Johnson had the ball in the corner, and it looked like it probably should have just been a tie-up, but another official called. Was it Mark Davis who made the call? I don't know. Called
he's
the foul.
Bitched to the refs ever since he came into the league.
But he's like screaming at Lauren Holtkamp, who's the female official there. And she's like screaming back at him, I didn't make the call. Like, what do you want? You know? And it's like, what are you doing? You're not even screaming at the right official. Like, it's so ingrained in him to just bitch at the officials. It's unbearable at this point.
All right. Well, now that we're piling on, I'm going to say this because, why the hell not? On Tatum, too. Put your kid to bed. No, Chris.
Really?
So,
are you serious?
Chris, I'm 1,000% serious. So the wife and I went to the game against Milwaukee a couple of weeks ago. It's a Friday night game that tips by the time, you know, ESPN game, like 8 o'clock. Yeah. The kid's what, like 3 or whatever he is?
I don't know how old Deuce is. How old?
Yeah,
he's young.
He's 3. At some point, like, I'm no parent, so maybe I'm, you know, over my skis on this, but just, you know, go with my gut. My eyes work. We had good seats. We're looking. The kid's like falling asleep, and I believe it's his mom that's looking after him, like on the sideline there. Like, it's 10 o'clock at night. Put the kid to bed. Like, put the kid to bed. It's not right. Like, he shouldn't be there in a late night game. It's a 3-year-old kid. Like, dude, what are you doing?
I wonder what his sleep schedule's like.
The kid needs to see daddy play basketball. Like, it's 82-game schedule. Like, okay, have him show up to some of the games. Put the kid to bed. Put Deuce to bed. Like, what are you doing? Okay, I needed to get that off my chest because we've been talking about this ever since we went, because I thought, like, it's 10 o'clock at night. The kid's like a rag doll in his mom's hand, in the grandmom's hands.
Oh, poor Deuce.
The crowd's going nuts. Like, you know, his daddy hits a big shot. Like, come on. Put him to bed.